Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi. Today we are going to discuss anticholinergic drugs, or which are also called cholinoreceptor blocking drugs, or which are also called parasympatholytic drugs. We have already discussed cholinoreceptor activating drug or agonist. Today our topic is very important as far as our academics is concerned, because it is very commonly asked in the examination, very commonly asked in VIVOS examination, and also in practical, which we are performing in experimental laboratory, especially antagonism, phenomena of antagonism. My topic is very important, and I'm discussing with Professor Muhammad Naeem Iqbal. As we know, the cholinoreceptors, they are of two types, muscarinic and nicotinic subgroups. So they are divided into anti-muscarinic and anti-nicotinic drugs. Those which are blocking the on the nicotinic receptor, depending upon which receptor they are blocking. Those we know that nicotinic receptor, they are named as NM and NN. So those which are at a neuromuscular junction, they are commonly called a neuromuscular junction blocker or skeletal muscle relaxant, and those which are going to block ganglion receptors are at N site, they are called ganglion blockers. But in this chapter, today we are going to discuss those which are specifically blocking the muscarinic receptors. As we know, muscarinic receptors are named from M1 to M5, M1, M2, M3, M4 and M5. M4 and 5, they are mainly in the CNS, while M1 is mainly in the they are located in the CNS, neurons and autonomic postganglionic cell bodies and many presynaptic sites. M2 receptor, they are located in the myocardium, smooth muscles, organs and some neuron sites, while M3 receptor are most common on effector cell membranes, especially dendritic and smooth muscle cells. So these drugs, they are going to block these receptors, and by blocking these receptors, they are not going to give access to the acetylcholine, which is agonist, to these receptors. So they are pure antagonist, competitive, and this blockade is a surmountable. That means if you increase the concentration of agonist, this is going to overcome the blockade. The muscarinic receptor blocking drugs, which are also called parasympatholytic or anti-muscarinic drugs, they are divided according to the chemical nature of the drugs. Number one group is natural balanoalkaloids. Examples are atropine and scopolamine. Second group is semi-synthetic and synthetic substitute of balanoalkaloids. They are further subdivided into two groups. Number one, quaternionamines. Examples are glycopyrrolate, isopropamide, mebendazolate, methamphetamine, second group is tertiamines, which are highly lipid soluble. They are not charged. They can cross blood-brain barrier, and they are easily absorbed from the mucous membrane and even skin. like atropine, dicyclomine, oxbetynine, and oxfencyclamine. Second way of classifying is according to the clinical uses, which is called therapeutic classification. And for that sake, the drugs which are used as antispasmodics, that means they relieve the spasm of the different viscera, holoviscus, GIT and other smooth muscles. The drugs which are included as, which are used as antispasmodics, atropine, scopolamine, dicyclomine, oxfencyclamine. Then those drugs which are used as mediatics, that means they are going to cause mediasis or dilatation of the pupil. Drugs included in this group are atropine, scopolamine, humetropine, cyclopentolate, tropicamide. And then third group are those drugs which are used for the treatment of Parkinsonism. The drugs included in this group are benzotropine, because this was a very old time-tested drugs which are used in the treatment of Parkinsonism, which is a neurotic disease or related with the CNS, where there are tremors, rigidity, excessive salivation. So to relieve rigidity and the tremors, the drug which are used like benzotropine, atropine, bipredine, orphenadrine, procyclidine, etc., they are used for this treatment. Then those drugs which are used for the treatment of asthma, although for the treatment of asthma, beta-stimulant drugs are beta-2 stimulant drugs are agonistic drug. They are the drug of choice. They are safe drug. But in some refractory cases where those drugs, they are not effective, or the control is not effective, or there are side effects of those drugs, you can use these anticholinergic drug specific like ipratropium or triotropium. Another group which is used for different urinary disorders, when there is a due to inflammation or other spasm of the urine, there is urgency or frequency of micturition. So for that sake, we can use the drugs like oxybutynin, toltriodine, propionine. These are highly selective anticholinergic drugs. Then those drugs which are used for gastric ulcer, although the H2 blockers and proton pump inhibitors, they are now the drug of choice for the treatment of gastric ulcer. But in some cases, we can use these highly selective anticholinergic drugs like pirenzepine and tolenzepine. These are highly selective for muscarinic M1 receptors. Then next group is treatment of cholinergic crisis in organophosphorus compound poisoning or in mushroom poisoning due to these cholinesterase inhibitor which are used as insecticide or pesticide in agriculture, are those people who are using mushroom as edibles. So some wild mushrooms, they can cause cholinergic poisoning. There is excessive salivation, pinpoint pupil, and bradycardia. So when there is poisoning due to organophosphorus compound or mushroom poisoning, we can use atropine, which is a life-saving drug, for this indication, and we have to use atropine in very heavy doses. Now we discuss the prototype drug, which is atropine. Among these anticholinergic drugs or antimuscarinic drugs, atropine is a prototype of these drugs. Atropine and naturally occurring congeners are tertiary amines, and it is an alkaloid ester of tropic acid. As far as the source of atropine is concerned, it is obtained from the plants Atropa belladonna, which is also called deadly nightshade, and from the Thura stramonium, which is called thorn apple or sacred datura. The source of scopolamine, which is hyoscine, it occurs in Hyoscyamus niger, which is also called henbane. The L-isomer, which is negatively charged, of both alkaloids are at least 100 times more potent than D-isomer. Synthetic and semi-synthetic substitute of belladonna alkaloids, a variety of semi-synthetic and fully synthetic molecules have anti-muscarinic effects. As far as the distribution of these drugs are concerned, atropine and other tertiary agents, they are widely distributed because they are lipid soluble. They are widely distributed in the body. Significant levels are achieved in CNS within 30 minutes to 1 hour. Scopolamine is rapidly and fully distributed to CNS, where it has greater effect than most other anti-muscarinic drugs. In contrast, the quaternary derivatives are poorly taken up by CNS because they cannot cross the blood-brain barrier and therefore are relatively free at low doses of CNS effects. As far as the metabolism and excretion of these drugs are concerned, atropine disappears rapidly from the blood after administration with a half-life of rapid phase from half an hour to 2 hours, while in slow phase the half-life is 13 hours. About 60%, 50 to 60% of the dose is excreted unchanged in the urine. Most of the rest appears in urine as hydrolysis and conjugation products. The drug's effects on parasympathetic functions declines rapidly in all organs except on the eye. Effect on the iris and ciliary muscles persists for more than 72 hours, that means 3 days. As far as the mechanism of action is concerned, atropine and other its congeners, they cause reversible or competitive, which is a surmountable blockade of cholinomimetic action at muscarinic receptors. That means if you increase the amount of agonist, this blockade can be overcome. So tissues which are blocked by atropine or atropine-like drug, most sensitive tissues are the salivary, bronchial and sweat glands, while the secretion from acid by gastric parietal cell is least sensitive. So atropine highly selective for muscarinic receptors. Atropine does not distinguish between M1, M2 and M3 subgroups of muscarinic receptors. In contrast, other anti-muscarinic drugs have moderate selectivity for one or another of these subgroups. When atropine binds to the muscarinic receptors, it prevents action such as the release of inositol triphosphate, IP3, and the inhibition of adrenaline cyclase that are caused by muscarinic agonists. As far as the pharmacological effects are concerned, organ system effects, first the CNS, atropine has minimal stimulatory effects on CNS, while scopolamine has more marked CNS effects, producing drowsiness and amnesia in sensitive individuals. While tremors of Parkinson's disease, they are reduced by centrally acting anti-muscarinic drugs like atropine and scopolamine. Then second part, vestibular disturbance, especially in motion sickness or seasickness, appear to involve muscarinic cholinergic transmission. So scopolamine especially is effective in preventing or reversing these disturbances. As far as the effects on eye are concerned, the pupillary constrictor muscle depend upon muscarinic cholinoreceptor activation. So activation is blocked by topical atropine and other drugs as tertiary anti-muscarinic drugs. This blockade will result in unopposed sympathetic dilator activity will cause mydriasis. So this is going to cause mydriasis or dilatation of the pupil. And these dilated pupils, they were considered cosmetically desirable during Renaissance and account for the name Belladonna, which is the Italian word, and that means beautiful lady, because this was considered, dilatation of pupil was considered as a sign of beauty. The second most important ocular effect of anti-muscarinic drug is cycloplegia, that is, that weakens contraction of the cilia muscles, or cycloplegia, and that causes loss of ability to accommodate, and in a fully atropinized eye cannot focus for near vision. Both mydriasis and cycloplegia are then the effects on the respiratory system, smooth muscles and glands of the airway receive a vagal innervation. Administration of atropine can cause bronchodilation and reduce secretion in the normal individuals. This effect is more marked in patients with airway disease like bronchial asthma or COPD or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. So anti-muscarinic drugs are not as useful as beta adrenoceptor stimulants in the treatment of bronchial asthma because they are the drug of choice, but anti-muscarinic agents are useful in some patients with asthma or COPD. Anti-muscarinic drugs are frequently used prior to administration of inhalant anesthetics to reduce the accumulation of secretion in trachea and possibility of laryngeal spasm. Then effects on the gastrointestinal tract are GIT. Anti-muscarinic drugs have dramatic effects on motility and some of the secretory functions of the GIT. Anti-muscarinic drugs have marked effects on salivary secretion leading to dryness of mouth, while gastric secretion is blocked less effectively. The volume and amount of acid, pepsin and mucin are all reduced, but large doses of atropine may be required, while pranzepine and a more potent or large olanzapine reduce gastric acidification with fewer adverse effects. While GIT motility is affected from stomach to the colon, wall of the viscera are relaxed, tone as well as the propulsive movements are diminished by using these atropine-like drugs. Then the effects on the genitourinary tract, they relax smooth muscles of the ureter and bladder wall and slows widening. This action is useful in the treatment of spasms induced by inflammation. Although for inflammation you need antibacterial antibiotics to improve this inflammation, but symptomatically you can use atropine and atropine-like drugs. Or following surgery like prostatectomy or neurological condition, but it can precipitate urinary retention in elderly men who have prostatic hyperplasia. These drugs do not have significant effect on uterus. Then the effects on the sweat glands, sympathetic cholinergic fiber innervate sweat gland. So atropine suppresses the thermoregulatory sweating. In adults, body temperature is elevated by this effect only if large doses are administered. But in infants and children, even ordinary doses may cause atropine fever, especially in hot weather. So one has to be very careful when giving atropine or atropine-like drug to infants and children, especially in hot weather. Then the therapeutic application or clinical uses of these atropine-like drugs. Number one, the Parkinson's disease. Although there is a deficiency of dopamine in nigrocidal system, which is giving this disease, but there is imbalance between the dopamine and acetylcholine. There is overactivity of acetylcholine. So the drug of choice for the treatment of liver Parkinsonism is levodopa, but in some condition where levodopa is giving you side effects or is not useful or is not controlling the sign and symptom of the disease, we can use in combination with atropine-like drugs with levodopa. So adjunct therapy, that means we combine levodopa with anticholinergic drugs to relieve the tremors and rigidity as well as the excessive salivation. Second, motion sickness, especially scopolamine, because it is very useful, time-tested drug in seasickness. We can use as skin patches intravenously or by tablet form, we can use it. It's very useful. Then in ophthalmic disorders, main use is for causing the dilatation or mydriasis, for ophthalmic examination, retinal examination, retinoscopy. And second use is to prevent synecdoche formation or adhesion formation in case of uveitis or iritis. We use atropine along with meiotic drops, we alternate, so we don't give time to make permanent adhesion between iris and the lens. As far as the respiratory disorders where we can use these atropine-like drugs, mainly as pre-operative medication when we are preparing the patient for anesthesia or for operation, when anesthetic such agents like ether, which is irritating the respiratory passage and increasing the respiratory secretions and is producing laryngeal spasms, we can use atropine. It decreases the possibility of laryngospasm as well as the respiratory secretion. Scopolamine also produces significant amnesia for the events associated with the surgery and obstructive delivery, a side effect that was considered desirable because the patient will be secured from psychological trauma. Second indication for respiratory disease, like asthma, treatment of asthma, ipratropium can be used as aerosol route and it is administered, will give maximum concentration at bronchial target tissues with minimum systemic effects. It is also useful in COPD or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, particularly in chronic smokers. So drug like tiotropium, which is a cotinine aerosol and cotinine ammonium amine compound, it can be used. It's a long acting. As far as the cardiovascular disorders where we can use atropine like drugs, marked reflex discharge sometimes accompanying the pain of myocardial infarction and may result in sufficient depression of SN or AV node functions to impair cardiac output. So the parenteral administration of atropine or similar antimuscarinic drug is appropriate therapy in this situation. So to prevent vagal discharge, we can use atropine. And then for the GIT or gastrointestinal tract disorders, antimuscarinic agents are used in especially traveler diarrhea. They are often combined with an opioid antidiarrheal drug. The classical combination of atropine with diphenoxylate is available under many clinical trade names. For example, Lomotil in both tablet and liquid form. We can use it for traveler diarrhea. Then in urinary disorders, atropine and other antimuscarinic drugs have been used to provide symptomatic relief in the treatment of urinary urgency caused by minor inflammatory disorders. But the inflammation should be treated with antibiotics along with these atropine-like drugs, which are going to give symptomatic relief. Oxybutynin is often used to relieve bladder spasm after urological surgery like prostatectomy. Tordirodine and it's a M1/M3 selective antimuscarinic is used in adults with urinary incontinence. Probiverine, a newer antimuscarinic agent, has been approved for use in elderly institutional patients to reduce incontinence of urine in different psychological ailments. In mushroom poisoning, which is mushrooms, they are used as wild mushrooms. They are eaten in different societies because it can cause cholinergic poisoning. So we can use atropine to overcome this cholinergic poisoning. Other application, condition like hyperhidrosis, which is excessive excessive sweating, is sometimes reduced by antimuscarinic agents. So these are important clinical application of these anticholinergic drugs. Then the adverse effects when we are using atropine by blocking the muscarinic receptors, it can produce dryness of mouth, it can produce midriasis or cycloplegia, failure of accommodation, then tachycardia, constipation, hot and flushed skin, agitation and delirium. Body temperature is frequently elevated Children, especially infants, are very sensitive to the hypothermic effects of atropine. Therefore, atropine should be considered a highly dangerous drug when overdoses occur in children or infants, especially in hot weather. When atropine has been taken in toxic doses, the sign and symptom of its toxicity is memorized in the adage, like dry as a bone, blind as a bat, red as a beet, and mad as a hatter, to just remember the toxic symptom of the drug. Then contraindications, where we can use these drugs. Contraindication to use antimuscarine drugs are relative, not absolute. Antimuscarine drugs are contraindicated in patients with glaucoma, especially close angle glaucoma, because it can lead to acute attack of glaucoma, which may be the cause of blindness. So one has to be very careful. If there is a history of glaucoma, one should not use atropine-like drugs. Or in elderly men, especially antimuscarinic drugs should be avoided in patients with history of prostatic hyperplasia, because it can lead to acute retention. It slows gastric emptying, so may increase symptoms with gastric ulcer. So the patient with gastric ulcer, because by delaying the gastric emptying, it can precipitate the symptoms of gastric ulceration. So these are the few contraindications where we should not use these antimuscarinic drugs. With this, we finish this topic of anticholinergic or parasympathetic.